Good morning. My name is Eunice Reiser, and I will be your moderator for this morning. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan, operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and various parts of the world. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word our Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord or God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many, but we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by the letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edge of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form could only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this selfsame spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. The simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, What was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Our 10 primary constitutional objectives and aims are as follows. To help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. 2, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. 3, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. 4, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures compared to religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. 5, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. 6, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. 7, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. 8, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. 9, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace and our slogan is speak the truth. This morning we will have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. We will have a song and a scripture reading of Acts, the second chapter, by Dr. Marlon Love.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's a time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, Father of this creation. We are so glad to be here, and we ask you to take our ignorance out of us, because there is a lot of things sometimes we don't understand, and this is why we are here in this school of the highest learning, and keep feeding us with this knowledge, wisdom, and understanding of you. We need for the trip everyone have to take sooner or later. Thank you, I say one more time, for all the things you give us in this earth. We live according to your purpose and your plan. And thank you very much. I say all those things and in your only son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Good evening. Good afternoon, class. Good morning. I'll be reading the scripture reader tonight, today, out of the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by A.B. Traynor with the Scripture Research Association. I'll be reading Acts, the second chapter. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, while they were all with one accord in one place, suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and rested upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwellings, and they were dwelling at Jerusalem, Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded, because that every man heard them speak in his own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, Behold, are not all these which speak Galatians? And how hear we every man in our own tongue, wherein we were born, Parthians and Medes and Elamites, and the dwellers in Mesopotamia and in Judea and Cappadocia and Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia in Egypt and in parts of Libya about Cyrene, and strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes, Cretes and Arabians, we do hear them speak in our tongues and wonderful works of Elohim. And they were all amazed and were in doubt, saying one to another, What meaneth this? Others mocking said, These men are full of new wine and are drunken. But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, Ye men of Judea and all ye that dwell in Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words. For these are not drunken, as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith Yahweh, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in heaven above, and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before that great and terrible day of Yahweh come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of Yahweh shall be saved. Ye men, sons of Israel, hear these words. Yahshua of Nazareth, a man approved of Yahweh among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which Yahweh did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and the foreknowledge of Yahweh, ye have taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain, whom Yahweh hath raised up, having loosed the pains of the death, because it was not possible that he should be holden of it. For David speaketh concerning him, I have set Yahweh always before my face, for he is on my right hand, that I should not be moved. Therefore did my heart rejoice, and my tongue was glad. Moreover, also my flesh shall rest in hope, because thou wilt not leave my soul in Sheol, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou hast made known to me the ways of life. Thou shalt make me full of joy with thy countenance. Men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his sepulcher is with us unto this day. Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that Yahweh hath sworn with an oath to him, that of the fruit of his loins according to the flesh, he would rise up with the Messiah to sit on his throne. He, seeing this before, spake of the resurrection of the Messiah, that his soul shall not be left in Sheol. And his soul was not left in Sheol, neither did his flesh see corruption. This Yahshua hath Yahweh raised up, whereof we all are witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of Yahweh exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he hath shed forth this which ye now see and hear. For David is not ascended into the heavens, but he saith himself, Yahweh said unto my Elohim, sit thou on my right hand, until I make thy foes thy footstool. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that Yahweh hath made that same Yahshua, whom ye have crucified, both king and Messiah. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent, and be immersed every one of you in the name of Yahshua the Messiah, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is unto you and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as Yahweh our Elohim shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this perverse generation. Then they that gladly received his word were immersed, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in the breaking of bread and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together, and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods, and parted with them to all men, and every man had need. And they continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their food with gladness and singleness of heart, praising Yahweh and having favor with all the people. And Yahweh added to the congregation daily as it were being saved. I have read Acts, the second chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Salas and Dr. Love. And before I call the first speaker, I would like to say welcome, Roxanne Mitchell. And I'm glad that I did get you the right link and you are able to be here this morning. So with that, I will call our first speaker, which will be the dean of our school, Dr. Marlene Love.
Good morning once again, morning, class. Good to be here. Good to see everybody here. And those that are on Zoom and YouTube as well. We're always appreciative to have something to say in front of the body of Yahshua the Messiah about the things that we've been shown and that we've come to understand and to hopefully edify those who are seeking the truth. These things that we speak of and that I speak of, and I speak from the things that I've learned in this school since coming into this school, having been delivered to me by way of Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, who had a divine vision and revelation in the year of 1931. Now, let it be known that I've never spoken to Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley as far as having a conversation, as far as him telling me that I need to do anything. So what I'm expressing, that the body or the vessel that the Holy Spirit had given the information of what Moses wrote and John wrote was delivered to Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley. And he subsequently had these charts that you see all around this class. You have a 40-plate chart and you have 7 primary charts that go into the purpose, pattern, and plan of Yahweh unto salvation. He went so much to name the first chart that he had sanctioned and drawn out, called the chart on the pattern or plan of salvation. You follow? So this man, having had received the vision, is something that I've come to have been shown how that visions aren't anything new in and of itself. Number one, it always was a thing for me as a child, since I have grown up in this school. Being young, when I was attending on a regular basis with my parents and whatnot, and when I would get out in my school days, and I recall conversations and information about how can one believe in a man's interpretation of the Bible. I, being young and not knowing anything, only having heard it and Paul parroted much of what I said, you know, I would say no J, no Jesus, essentially. Not really knowing anything about how to and why to explain why the name could not be Jesus Christ as a Savior at that time. And so when the question came up, how can you believe a man that purports that he knows or knew the purpose of Yahweh? Call it God if you want to, because that's what I was hearing at the time, because you didn't have Yahweh, Elohim, Yahshua as expressly expressed as you have now, because I was, at that known time, was a rarity besides the sacred name movement, when they, at the same time, were given the same information about putting Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua in a Bible. You follow? And Dr. Kinley didn't go along and didn't begin to purport the names of Yahweh, Elohim, Yahweh, Yahshua at that time, because he didn't want to be conflicted or confused with having been associated with A.B. Trainer and the Scripture Research Association, or the Sacred Name Movement at the then known time. You follow? So, yet, nevertheless, he still maintained and still began to preach and teach in what one would call Lord God and Jesus Christ, until an appointed day and time where he said, you're no longer going to be able to be saved in the name of Lord God and Jesus Christ. Understanding that Yahweh has a purpose, and it repeats itself over and over and over again. We talked about it some in the last class, and I think I want to go back there on Thursday's class in the textbook when we were finishing off about the correlation between this tabernacle pattern and the migratory trek. You follow? I think it was important and I missed a step, or I didn't conclude it as I had wanted to. You have a book, Eunice? I got it right here. Look at that. I'm on Johnny on the spot today.
Yes, you are.
It's all right. So what we're expressing, the things that we've come to know, that I've come to know, of how the Holy Spirit operates through vessels. It's the only way that the Holy Spirit operated through was vessels or his creatures. You follow? Because even in the moderation, we have it, and it expresses that Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this shape and form, and he the cloud is symbolizing, it's not Yahweh, but it's symbolizing Yahweh. Because we know that we cannot see, touch, sound, taste, or smell pure spirit. And those are all five senses whereby we're able to learn anything about anything. Therefore, it behooved Yahweh, knowing this, you follow, knowing he was not going to be able to be perceived in this state and condition with his divine attributes in operation before the world ever knew anything about anything. And he, knowing that he had to divest himself, I'm going to say it like that, divest himself, because he said that mankind were not going to be able to perceive him in this condition. Therefore, he divested himself in part, not in totality. I mean, it wasn't that he left this state of ontological perfection and went into or became Elohim, and there was no longer any more pure spirit of Yahweh. You understand? In part, this is why this chart shows this cloud going all around the edges of this chart. Follow? Now, everything abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh, in and out. Because over there in Acts, the 17th chapter is talking about that spirit being in the body and out of the body. See, we breathe. You follow? If you run over the Psalms 150:6, you don't have to get it, but it talks about everything that has breath praises the name of Yahweh. You follow? That's in the body and out of the body. That's Yahweh, pure spirit. And Yahweh changes not. You follow? Yet he transmuted into this 3-4. He transmuted into Elohim, a super incorporeal being. That is, taking on the shape and form of these attributes whereby it might be perceived in divine visions. Just as you have these 73 souls here at the plateau of this mountain on the second trip of Moses' trip, they saw this Elohim. You follow? Now, it's this Elohim, it's the Word or Son. This is what Yahweh created and went out of the creating business, as I've been taught. Anything else? Feel free to call. Let me have a discussion about it. Not a problem. But what we have is Yahweh Elohim creating the creation. You follow? And his pattern, he created this creation pattern after a tabernacle, a threefold tabernacle, whereby Elohim expressed to Moses that this is going to be a tabernacle that he wants built in the midst of them. He was speaking in the midst of them because this tabernacle is going to be Yahweh Elohim's dwelling place in this threefold tangible sanctuary that they built. This that Moses saw was intangible. This in the wilderness they built was tangible. And this tabernacle was made in the image and likeness of man. How so? Remember, when the children of Israel began to construct this threefold tabernacle, they were encamped around this tabernacle in four sides. West, yes. North, east, and south. You follow? On this four sides is likened to our body. How so? That tabernacle was moved for 40 years, being erected and dismantled and moved all about. Just as our limbs got two legs and two arms. That's your four sides to your one tabernacle pattern. And these limbs move you about throughout your day. That's likened to the four sides here of the children of Israel encamped around this tabernacle. Now he's dwelling in the midst of them because, hey, as they're set up around this tabernacle, they're in sets of three tribes on every side of this tabernacle. You follow? Now these three tribes that are set up here count your 12. You follow? Now we understand that if it's counting 12, you have your four sides that all three were camped about, and then on each one of your members, your hand, you got an upper arm, a lower arm, and your hand. That counts as three. Then you have an upper arm, a lower arm, and a hand. That counts as six. See, each one of these are principles in the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah to get one to see that how we're made in the image and likeness of Elohim. You follow? And your legs, subsequently an upper leg, a lower leg, and your foot. You follow? That's nine. And then your last leg, you got an upper leg, a lower leg, and your foot. That's 12. It's paralleling that which was built in the tabernacle after man. You follow? Now, why do we say this? Because this tabernacle, I'm going to need it, Exodus, yeah, I think it's Exodus 8, 9, and 10, but there's another Exodus I want to demonstrate. I think it's 34, Exodus 34 chapter. Yeah, it is. Forty. Now, before we go there, we're expressing and showing how this tabernacle that Elohim transformed into or transmuted into, whereby Moses saw how the days of the creation was created. We know that he saw this tabernacle, and he saw the 7 days of the creation on his second trip. You follow? Now, I want to go cut break to the textbook, because we're going to get and talk about Acts, the second chapter, and we want to talk about the purpose of Yahshua the Messiah. You follow? Because this is going to have to understand it this way in order to be edified by what has been demonstrated down through the ages and dispensations. Give me some water. Yep.
Seventh plane is where we were.
Yes. I want to just to briefly recap. We started at the bottom, right?
So we want to start back at one?
No, I'm not going to want to start at one. We can just kind of fast forward through one, because it's showing the law, prophet, and the fulfillment by Yahshua the Messiah. Talking about that gate, because remember, on this tabernacle that we have, right, there's seven steps. It's in three parts: the most holy place, the holy place, and the court roundabout. This is the one tabernacle pattern. You follow? Now, I've demonstrated how it's set up in the midst of the children of Israel. You follow? And where we're able to begin to see how this tabernacle works is when we are in the wilderness ourselves. If we're in darkness, the darkness can't comprehend the light. And we know that this tabernacle had light here in the holy place. So something has to be said in order to get one's attention, in order to see the light or the workings within this tabernacle. You follow? This is why we're using this man made in the image of Elohim by the pattern of the tabernacle, in order to show you why your extremities are the way they are. You follow? Because they're set up after a pattern. And so when we see as our head region and our chest region and our abdominal region, as depicted here, is set up with the most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. This is just your physical body. You follow? That's in operation, that you deal with, that you wash up, and that you got to contend with on a daily basis. And you can't get no new one. You might be able to get a part here or there, but you're not going to get a whole new body at all. So we're just simply demonstrating how you're made in the likeness and image of this pattern. And we've gone through it. And we say there's a gate. There's seven steps, and there's a gate. You follow? You have it on the board now? This gate is symbolic to our gate, where we are able to excrete our waste, if you would. You follow? Now, there's also a gate in this migratory pattern. You follow? Or they call it a greater or more perfect pattern. You follow? Or sanctuary. This is a greater or more perfect sanctuary. And it had a gate. And that gate was likened to the door. You follow? And it's this door that all men are going to have to come in through. You got that, Matthew 17 and 13, I believe? Can we have that read? We're just going to skimmy up through here real quick. Talking about a gate now. We're going to go through these seven steps according to the migratory pattern. And hopefully that is set up for the foundation to springboard off of and into something about that Holy Spirit that was ushered out on the day of Pentecost. You see?
Matthew 7:13.
Yes, ma'am.
Enter ye in. Sorry. Enter ye in by the narrow gate. Mm-hmm. For wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. Mm-hmm. And many there be which go in thereat.
See, many people come in through the straight gate. That's a court roundabout. People have heard this gospel from since it's been talked about. You follow? With Dr. Kinney in 1931. A lot of people heard the gospel, but they not all of them stayed in the gospel.
Sure.
We already have a certain group of them that's trying to splinter off, if you would, or come up with some other wild gospel. You follow what I'm saying? Not sticking to the true gospel, which they all entered in by the straight gate because they've heard it. But you can't do anything just to get in through this gate, right? Because you have to give up something on this second step. Let's move on to that next step, if you would. And that next step is death or an altar. You follow?
1 Corinthians 5 and 7?
Yeah, that'll do us fine.
Get rid of the old leaven.
Get rid of the old leaven, read.
That ye may be bread of a new baking.
Now look, that old leaven is that leaven that is the egotistical, misdirected personality that we all have and come in through that gate with. And that got to go. That's got to be put on the altar. You understand? That thinking, that opinion, that imagination that you think you know something about this great panoramic vision. You follow? And you got to get rid of that leaven, because that leaven was what made that bread rise. That's why when they had in Passover, they had unleavened bread.
Right.
You follow? That's the purpose of why they had unleavened bread. You follow? Keep reading a little bit.
that ye may be bread of a new baking, as it were, unleavened Passover bread. For the Messiah, our Passover was sacrificed for us.
Yahshua is that true sacrifice that sacrificed for us. Back here was a lamb that the children of Israel had to take out. And you're not part of the children of Israel, physically speaking.
Right.
You follow? So get that I'm of Abraham concept out of your mind. You are who you are, and they are who they were. They are an example unto us now, whereby we can see what that lamb represented. And we now can see that that lamb back here was a type and shadow of this lamb back here. Because why? They had to slay this lamb, right? And they had to take that blood and put it on the inside on the four points of their door. Follow? The mantle, the two side posts, and they dip from the basin.
Right.
They did that. This is the same way they did Yahshua the Messiah. They put him on, they killed him, they put him on the cross, they whipped him and put him on the cross. You follow? Put a crown of thorns on his head, like unto the mantle, a nail in each side of his hands, and they nailed him in his base of the feet. 4 points. That's lining up to this 4 points here on this door. You follow? You follow? Later on, we're going to talk about the door, and we're going to see that he said he's the door. You follow? He's already said he's the straight gate, right? And he now you say that he's that sacrifice, or our Passover, if you would. This lamb right here, that was their Passover, children of Israel.
Right.
Now, Yahshua is our Passover, but we have to see how to use this migratory pattern, which is a greater, more perfect tabernacle pattern, in order to see Yahshua working his work, or instituting, if you would. This Passover here, this first Passover, that you read in Exodus, the 12th chapter, was the initiating Passover. This is why this was instituted at this time. Yahshua came in and fulfilled it at his time. You follow? Within the same dispensation, mind you. He was born under the law, he was raised under the law, and he died under the law in order to what? Fulfill that which he instituted in the fourth dispensation. You follow? Mm-hmm. Now, when we can see that principle, we can move on of what that altar is, or what we have to give up. You follow? Yahshua would say, pick up your cross and follow me. Well, how are we following? We're following in the understanding and the learning of this migratory pattern, or this tabernacle pattern, if you will. Because this pattern is a pattern that can be put on everything. You follow? And whereby when we can see where you're at according to this pattern, it'll take away the fear of wondering where you're at within your consciousness. We're just using the tabernacle pattern that's been laid out since the dawn of time for us to utilize and to teach and to rehearse over and over and over and over again. Because many people can't come in here and just correlate Moses in the migratory pattern, even though they heard it all their lives. You see, it takes an understanding in order to see and pull out these principles that we're talking about here. Let's move on to this water, which was the next step within this threefold or sevenfold tabernacle pattern. Okay? You have the gate. Step one, you have the brazen altar of sin sacrifice. Step two, and now we're at the brazen laver. Step three.
John 13:4-5.
Read.
He riseth from supper and laid aside his garment and took a towel and girded himself.
Mm-hmm.
After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded.
See, that labor is also dealing, that we talked about on Thursday, that we're dealing with a washing. That the Yahshua Messiah that you're reading now is talking about washing the disciples. Just as the high priest and two low priests had to be washed at this labor. Mm-hmm. See, it wasn't always just animals at this labor getting washed, you follow, before they got put on this altar. See, we also have to be washed by the, we're washed by the gospel or the preaching of the gospel, because that's what we're being baptized in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. That's our baptism now. But back then, they had to be washed, physically and literally so. You have it read here in John, right? This is what their baptism was. Grab me Exodus 30 and 18 right quick. Because what we see here in the so-called New Testament, we're going to have to see that back here in the scriptures, because we're going to go by the scriptures of the law and the prophets. Read.
Exodus 30 and 18. Mm-hmm. Thou shalt also make a laver of brass.
That's that laver that we're talking about here in the court roundabout. It's going to make it of brass. Read.
And its foot also of brass to wash withal.
See, they had a laver. See, this laver that we have on this chart is showing like one body of water. But see, there was a lower laver with a foot that also had a trough of water. You follow? And this is where he's talking about now. Read.
And thou shalt put it between the meeting tent of the congregation.
This tent, this two parts, this holy place and the most holy place was the meeting tent. And it's going to be between what?
Between the meeting tent of the congregation and the altar.
And the altar is sin sacrifice.
That's right.
This is where his labor is going. And it's got two parts. See, people think it's all about the flesh and animals, which it was, because that's what they was washing. But it's also about a washing of the high priest and the two low priests. Mm-hmm. And the cleansing. And they had to do that on a daily basis. Read.
And thou shalt put water therein.
Mm-hmm.
For Aaron and his sons shall wash their hands and their feet
mm-hmm.
thereat.
Mm-hmm.
When they go into the meeting tent of the congregation,
mm-hmm.
they shall wash with water,
mm-hmm.
that they die not.
See, you die if you don't wash. You die according to an understanding. And this is why Joshua washed their feet. Mm-hmm. And Peter talked about he don't need to have his feet
yeah.
washed. You follow? Remember the story?
Yeah.
When Joshua began to do that, he said, Joshua, you don't need to wash my feet. And Joshua would tell him, hey, man,
yeah.
if I don't wash your feet, you don't have no part of me in heaven. This was heaven, this holy place, to be able to operate and function, to have the gratitude to be in the holy place, let alone the most holy place, just the holy place, to be able to see Joshua Messiah having brought you through the straight gate be it that you even give up anything of your own unleavened thoughts and unleavened bread and imaginations and concepts to be able to put yourself on here and then begin to be washed by the preaching of the gospel.
Right.
Hey, that's something to be thankful for. You follow? To see that much according to these principles that we're talking about. You follow? Not alone what your kidneys do for you, washing that blood on a continuous basis, right? This is what the kidneys in your body is set up after, a pattern after, in order to wash out the impurities.
Mm-hmm.
And you say you don't need to be washed, you don't need to hear the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah, or that you already got it and understand all the jots and tittles to it. I beg your pardon. When you understand how this laver here, the Red Sea, was a baptism unto all of Israel. You follow? I think that's Corinthians 1:10. First Corinthians 1:10. First Corinthians 1:10, I believe. Just grab that right quick for that water principle of the children of Israel. You follow?
First Corinthians 1:10.
I believe so. Mm. That it?
I beseech you, brother, be no division among you.
Colossians 1:10. I always lose this one. Baptized. First Corinthians 10:2. Start at 1. First Corinthians.
Oh,
I was close.
Okay. 10:2.
What did I say?
1:10, 10:2.
Mm-hmm.
And we were all baptized.
Start at 1, please.
Okay. Moreover, brethren,
uh-huh.
I would not that you should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea.
Now, hold on. There's that, you know, Saul saying that you don't want nobody to be ignorant, right? Now, I just got done expressing to you about that, how this labor was set up. There was an upper part and a lower part for washing of the high priest. And we had talked about Joshua the Messiah having washed the disciples' feet. You follow? Multiple things going on here with this labor at this point, or this third step of this sanctuary. You follow? And now we're expressing that, hey, the children of Israel had to take out that lamb. They had to put that blood on the door, because if they didn't, that death angel was coming. And sure enough, if you didn't have this blood on the inside of your household, individual household, representing that we each have to stand on our own tub, our own 2 feet, according when it comes to this gospel. Can't be calling out to Eunice. Can't be crying out where I'm at. You have to know for yourself of how this operation works. And we're expressing it a little bit here and there. Moreover, essentially, is what Saul is saying. Moreover, about this water, what about this Red Sea? Read.
And we're all baptized, and all passed through the sea, and we're all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea.
Now, this is what this is how the migratory pattern goes. See, this migratory pattern, this is a pattern of heavenly things, whereby we're seeing it wash the those who went through the Red Sea. But you also have to understand this, that they went through on dry land. They weren't getting wet with water.
Right.
But yet they were baptized. Saul said they was yet baptized. All our fathers were baptized. A million plus haven't gone through 603,550 to be exact. If those men, fighting men, men of knowledge or information coming through this Red Sea here, right? Not counting women and children. You follow? There's a principle there. Well, I don't want to go there on that right now. But just understand that they're going through this Red Sea being baptized. This is a labor according to the migratory pattern. You follow? Next. Step four.
John 10:9.
Mm-hmm.
I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture.
Now you're going in and out of here, into this quote roundabout and into this holy place. But you have to go through the door. And that door is Yahshua the Messiah. That door is he who Saul is speaking of in the second chapter of Acts. You follow? Yahshua the Messiah. Did we have it read? Acts 2.
Beginning?
No, I just started. We're talking about Yahshua the Messiah. Down to...
Hear the words of Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
21.
It's not fine.
And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of Yahweh shall be saved.
Mm-hmm.
Ye men, sons of Israel, hear these words.
Mm-hmm.
Yahshua of Nazareth, a man approved of Yahweh among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which Yahweh did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know. Him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of Yahweh, ye have taken, and by wicked hands have crucified and slain.
That's your door. That's going to be your way into the sanctuary, is through Yahshua Messiah. You follow? Because he said over there in John, where you had read, that he's the way, that he's the door. You follow? Now, these are the principles that we're looking at, the migratory pattern, and understand that this was also the door. I want to get back to that plane real quick. That's good for Yahshua being the door. But I want to get the fourth plane real quick.
Okay, go back to 10:9.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
No, I want Exodus 36, 37. Exodus 14:21, that's when Yahshua told Moses to raise his hand, you follow? And he parted the Red Sea when they saw the Egyptians bearing down on them. That's 14. But now we're going to read Exodus 36 and 37 about this door. Read.
And he made a hanging for the meeting tent door of blue and purple and scarlet and fine twine linen.
See, that's this first compartmental veil right here that we're looking at, that he's expressing, that he made it for the door. Keep reading.
And the five pillars of it with their hooks, and he overlaid their tops and their fillets with gold. But their five sockets were of brass.
Mm-hmm. That's what this door is here, at this step, this fourth plane issue Dr. Kinney is expressing here. Just like you have this fourth step here being that diaphragm that separates your chest region from your abdominal region. There's a thin diaphragm with blood vessels and capillaries there that was making up your blue, purple, and scarlet that divides these core roundabout or your abdominal region from your chest region here. You follow? Now that's the door, the curtain, that's that dividing point. You follow? And we know that you just had it red. It's also made of blue, purple, and scarlet. You follow? And this Red Sea, I think we need to go back to 10 and 9. That this Red Sea is likened to a door.
John 10 and 9?
I think so.
I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. Mm-hmm. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. Mm-hmm. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly.
That's Yahshua that's going to be coming in order to demonstrate.
Continue.
No, hold on. Go to Exodus 23. Yeah, start at 23 and
Exodus 23:18.
Mm-hmm.
Thou shalt not offer the blood of my sacrifice mm-hmm. with leavened bread,
mm-hmm.
neither shall the fat of my sacrifice remain until the morning.
Mm-hmm.
The first of the first fruits of thy land thou shalt bring into the house of Yahweh thy Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
Thou shalt not boil a kid in his mother's milk.
Mm-hmm.
Behold, I sent an angel before thee to keep thee in the way and to bring thee into the place which I have prepared.
See, what we're doing here is this here, this angel, this is the angel that's going to lead them into this door. It's like into Yahshua, the Messiah. And he's preparing them away into a place to eat, because this is where the two low priests and the high priest ate on this shewbread, and it has to be of unleavened bread. Mm-hmm. No one's going into the holy place without being washed and without having given up something. You follow? And you'll be able to come in and out, but you have to keep according to the way. Keep reading, please.
Beware of him and obey his voice.
Mm-hmm.
Provoke him not,
mm-hmm.
for he will not pardon your transgressions. For my
See,
name is
your transgressions is that unleavened. That has to be, you're not going to pardon that when you start ministering in and out of this tabernacle or the holy place. Keep reading.
But if thou shalt indeed obey his voice mm-hmm. and do all that I speak,
mm-hmm.
then I will be an enemy unto thee. Thine enemies
mm-hmm.
and an adversary unto thy adversaries.
See, he's going to be for you. He's going to fight for you. You follow? This is what this being washed in this sea is going to bode well for the children of Israel. If they adhere to what was being said. We know it hasn't, but now we're looking back and seeing that, hey, there's something that we have heard if we're down here listening to this gospel. And we also have to obey that word, which is inside of us. There's no written law anymore that we're following the Ten Commandments
right.
or 603 other judgment statutes and ordinances that we're following. Nothing's written. It's written in your heart and mind. This is the script by which we're going to be able to hear what's being written within us. Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
For my angel shall go before thee
mm-hmm.
and bring thee unto the Amorites,
mm-hmm.
the Hittites, and the Perizzites, and the Canaanites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, and I will cut them off.
At this door. That's what the angel's going to do. That's what Yahshua Messiah is going to do if we believe and if we follow. That's the fourth step. according to the tabernacle pattern and this migratory pattern. And Yahshua told us that he's the door. You follow?
Right.
In fulfillment of this. Mm-hmm. Now, next plane, 5.
John, you want to go 8:12? Or you want to start at John 8:12? John 6:35.
Okay. Yeah, go ahead and pick it up. It's fine.
Okay. John 8:12. Then spake Yahshua again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life.
Now that light we're talking about here, talking about the fifth step, we know that we have 7 steps in this tabernacle. Follow? And you say, well, why are he talking about the light when he's talking about, when we know that the fifth step is the entirety of the holy place? You follow? First step, the gate. Yahshua is the straight gate. You follow? The sacrifice. You follow? We know that Yahshua is our Passover, was our sacrifice when he died on the cross. You follow? Then you have this washing or this laver, whereby he washed the disciples' feet, and we know that the high priest and the two little priests had to be washed at this laver. We talked about this brass laver. And we just got done talking about this door. That's that fourth step. The fifth step is the entirety of the holy place. You follow? Now, within the holy place, this is where we say was prepared. Was a light, was a bread, and was an intercessor. These things are prepared for us in order to minister unto those who know not Yahweh. You follow? We have to understand that light and what that light represents in the tabernacle according to that bread and what that bread represents. Unleavened, not of your own righteousness, right, but of Yahweh's purpose and that intercessor. You follow? That is going to be, we'll read about it, which is Yahshua. We're not intercessing for anybody. That's why we're just vessels. We can receive and then expound, but we're not taking anything, we're not coming up with anything of ourselves. And if you do, you get caught. Just like Nadab and Abihu got caught when they're making their own intercess, their own incense up here of Yahweh, they got killed.
Right.
It wasn't the right mix.
Right.
It's got to be the right gospel, otherwise you'll get killed. You'll be spotted out. You follow? That's why they can come in here and be messing around. People come in and come out and then lose their estate, if you would. Hey, many people have come in and heard and preached beautiful sermons, but then now they then went back on what they were told and how they were told and what they were told. That's between them and Yahweh. But nonetheless, we have evidence of that.
Right.
You follow? So therefore, we have to understand that this light, right, mm-hmm, that was in the holy place was set up as the light who is Yahshua Messiah. You have it? Go ahead and reread what you just had.
Oh, okay.
17.
Oh, go 17?
You read 6, right?
Right. I did 6. I was going to go with 8 and 12. I did 8 and 12. Now I'm going with 6 and 35.
Okay, that's the bread and light. That's the bread, right?
Yeah.
Reread John 8 and 12 one more time for me,
okay,
please.
Then spake Yahshua again unto them, saying, mm-hmm, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life.
That's that light that we're following now. That's what we're learning about is Yahshua. Now go to the next one, please.
And Yahshua said unto them,
uh-huh,
I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall, mm-hmm, never hunger.
Now we're in the wilderness in this tabernacle, and he's that bread of life that the ministers, the high priest and the two little priests, ate off of. That's what the type was of this unleavened bread here, and that's Yahshua fulfilling them having eaten here in this holy place. Keep reading.
And he that believeth on me shall never thirst.
Mm-hmm.
But I say unto you that ye also have seen me and believe not. All that the Father gives me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. For I am come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me.
That's Yahshua, because he was that manna. Remember, the children of Israel had manna here in the wilderness, did they not? Coriander seed went out when they made flatbread here. That's that Yahshua coming down from heaven. That's the fulfillment that Yahshua is expressing here about this tabernacle. There was bread in here, but there was also manna according to the children of Israel. That's the fulfillment of that. You follow? Mm-hmm. That light was that light that filled fire by day, that cloud by day, and that fire by night. That's their fire according to the migratory pattern. And this is how this tabernacle pattern is mirrored, and we can see how Yahshua Messiah instituted it and then now fulfilled it. This is what we're looking at.
Okay? There's some more about the bread. That's here.
Go ahead.
48. I am the bread of life.
Mm-hmm.
Your father did eat manna in the wilderness.
There we go.
And are dead.
You see, they're dead eating that manna. Read.
This is the bread which cometh down from heaven.
Right.
That a man may eat thereof and not die.
Mm-hmm. See, Yahshua is that bread now that we're eating. We say we come and sup. People say gonna have to come and listen to the word and be filled. Well, this is what we're being filled with is the knowledge and understanding of Yahshua the Messiah. That's what we're supping on. You follow? We're not talking about eating after class and getting full and eating fruit. You follow? We're preaching and teaching the true water, the true bread, mm-hmm. which is Yahshua the Messiah. Anything else there?
I am the living bread
uh-huh.
which came down from heaven.
Mm-hmm.
If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever.
Mm-hmm.
And the bread that I will give is my flesh,
mm-hmm.
which I will give for the life of the world.
That's what he did for the life of the world. And he also instituted it back here. This is why we're saying he instituted the law and the prophets, everything he did according to this migratory pattern, which is a greater, more perfect sanctuary, because we can see how Yahshua, by way of Joshua, came in and lived to 110 years old and died and took off the flesh. You follow? As it were. And then how Yahshua came in and picked him right back up at 30 years old when Joshua appeared down here in Egypt at 30 years old. And then he runs the whole gamut. He goes out into the wilderness after that baptism, right? After that water, he goes out into that wilderness for 40 days, right? Just like he's picking up that 40 years of the children of Israel here in the wilderness.
Right.
And then he's tempted of that devil, talking about those bread that was set out here at the river Jordan, talking about that bread that Yahshua is tempted by Satan while he was out here in the wilderness. And this is that bread that Yahshua, Satan told him to make these stones into loaves of bread, right? And Yahshua said, don't tempt Yahweh. He's reading the same story that we're going over. Just as John, the Isle of Patmos, all he's doing is recanting the same story that Moses is seeing. Nothing new under the sun, as it were, right? And so now we understand these principles, allegories and metaphors in order to see the principle of what Yahshua Messiah is, which is a Holy Spirit and not just some man on the cross.
Right.
You follow?
Right.
And what he's saying and what he does and what he is doing is fulfilling. And when we see the principles of these being fulfilled by Yahshua, then we have faith in that which we can go on. Once we're filled with that whole outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which has already been ushered out, if you believe, you already contain it and have it, just have to believe and know the report. Keep reading. You got 17?
Oh.
I think that's it on there, right? Did you get
17 and 1. These words spake Yahshua and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said,
mm-hmm.
Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him.
Mm-hmm.
And this is life eternal, that they might know that
mm-hmm.
thou only art the true El, and Yahshua the Messiah, whom thou hast sent.
And that's Yahshua. That life eternal is to know that, who Yahweh has sent for our salvation, to know this migratory pattern. Keep reading.
I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the works which thou hast gavest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thy me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. I have declared thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world.
Mm-hmm.
Thine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word. Now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee. For I have given them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came out from thee.
Now look, Yahshua is saying that he told them what Yahweh told him to tell them. Yahshua came in the likeness of sinful flesh. You follow? Yahshua is not flesh. Yahshua came in the likeness of sinful flesh, and he took on this body. And he talked to his disciples walking around Judean and Palestinian hills for some 3.5 years, talking and teaching them about who he was, according to parables, as it were. Because there's a purpose and plan of Yahweh. That wasn't time for everybody and these people during the fourth dispensation. I keep pointing there. But when we're talking about Yahshua Messiah, you have to understand we're talking about him in the fourth dispensation of what he's doing and how he's setting up this inevitable outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which is himself, into the hearts and minds of people to know about him and what he's doing. This is why we're going over the tabernacle, the migratory pattern, Adam, Noah, Melchizedek, and Abraham, and how that promise was set up. And you see how that promise was an invisible promise that through his seed, Adam, singular, that he was going to be the salvation of the whole world. In this age, fourth age, whereby we can receive and know about that Holy Spirit. But until then, we rehearse and we go over the gate, the altar of sin and sacrifice, the brazen laver, the oil at the door, you follow? And going through how that light that Yahshua was and that bread of the gospel, what we're preaching and teaching, and that how Yahshua is our intercessor, you follow? Because I told them what you told me. He's that intercessor, you follow? And that intercessor is going to be the Holy Spirit. I think he's read over there in John. He talks about that intercessor, which is the Holy Spirit. It's going to bring all things back to our remembrance. What is he going to bring back to our remembrance? Our old childhood, our own leaven, high leaven?
No.
Not that, but this.
Right.
This is the story that he's going to bring back to remembrance. Mm-hmm. And he said, don't care about what you're going to say. Just go. Just as he told, on his way to Nineveh, no other prophet going to give besides Joel.
The only sign of the prophet. Yeah.
Jonah in the belly of the whale, right? He said, don't care about what you're going to say. You don't even want to go to Nineveh.
Mm-hmm.
But Yahshua said, go. But and once you understand the story and don't understand and have faith in who he is, he's going to bring back the words to say because it's his story that we're going to be preaching. You follow? And when you're confident in the setup of how he's patterned himself after everything according to this tabernacle pattern, you're not going to get lost. You can preach the gospel because this is what we're learning about. This is what Yahshua told the disciples of Yahweh told Yahshua to tell the disciples. It's the tabernacle. This is death, burial, and resurrection. It's the same story. Keep reading.
John. For I have given them.
Keep reading. You're right. Keep reading.
I have given them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came out from thee.
That's right.
And they have believed that thou didst send me.
Yes.
I pray for them. I pray not for the world.
You see?
But for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine.
That's who we are. We are Elohim if we understand and believe in who our Savior is. You follow? And he's an intercessor. He becomes an intercessor for us until, why? Because he's an intercessor for us because we're at this veil, which is that sixth step that we're going to talk about now. Now we're getting closer to home now. We went back in Egypt, that gate, and we're now at the sixth step because Yahshua had already given his boys all that he needed to give them. You follow? Those 11. Remember, Judas got sold out, right? And now you got those 11 that was on that day of Pentecost, right? That they that sure enough did come after 10 days, that after Yahshua ascended up into heaven, after spending 40 days on earth, that 10 days he's come back up, and now he's poured out his Holy Spirit. Now we're talking about the sixth plane or the sixth step. We already talked about that we're in the holy place now.
Right.
Now we're going to talk about this veil.
Hebrews 10 and 20.
Mm-hmm.
By a new and living way, mm-hmm. which he has consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh.
Now that's that flesh on this tabernacle. We're talking about this second compartmental veil, right? This is the sixth step. Now I'm going to need Joshua 3 and 1. Now remember, I just got done saying that Yahshua is fulfilling everything back here that was instituted by Joshua. You follow? And Joshua appeared down here at 30, right? And I just expressed how Yahshua began his ministry at 30. And then to fast track this story of Joshua, he's 30 years old here, and he comes into the wilderness and spends his 40 years with the children of Israel here. That's making up what? 40, that's 70, right? And now you have him in the Jerusalem or in the most holy place, having brought all them from Egypt into the most holy place, save three. Because you have to be vitally aware that not everybody that were in Egypt came to and through the Red Sea, tarried on earth or tarried in the wilderness for 40 years, and crossed over. That's not so. Only three of the original children of Israel crossed over into the most holy place. Everybody else were born in the wilderness, born in that holy place. See, all of that you were bringing in, it's all got to go. And this is what the type and the shadow of this migratory pattern is pointing out. You yourself ain't going to come in with your egotistical, misdirected personality. You have to take on a new nature, a new understanding according to, and a washing of the soul that you already got, and be cleaned up in this holy place. You're not getting a new one. You're not going to get an exchange of nothing.
No.
You're going to keep, you are perfect in how you're made, minus the gospel washing and cleaning you up. And that gospel take on shape and form within you, which is the Holy Spirit, which is his story. You follow? That's why there's no other gospel besides the one that we're preaching. We don't have to debate and contend about carnal ordinances, because that's what any other gospel pretty much is a carnal ordinance. They're going to slap something on you to have to do. And once they reveal what it is that they're going to deem you to do, you got. They're gotten. And so what we're expressing is that you're taking on a new body or a new nature that's going to cross over this River Jordan through, and the River Jordan being that sixth step or that sixth veil. You follow? Like that curtain in the holy place representing that sixth step. And it's at this step that flesh has to come off of your conscience about what you're thinking, mm-hmm. about what you feel, and how you like, and how you want. That's got to stop at this veil. You follow? Where are we at right
Joshua
now?
3 and 1.
Yes, Joshua 3 and 1.
And Joshua rose early in the morning.
Okay.
And they removed from Shittim,
mm-hmm.
and came to Jordan.
They came to Jordan. They came to the sixth step now, right? Read.
He and all the children of Israel and lodged there before they passed over.
All the children of Israel. Read.
And It came to pass after 3 days that the officers went through the host.
Mm-hmm.
And they commanded the people, saying, when ye see the Ark of the Covenant of Yahweh, your Elohim,
mm-hmm.
and the priests,
mm-hmm.
the Levites, bearing it,
mm-hmm.
then ye shall remove from your place mm-hmm. and go after it.
Mm-hmm.
Yet there shall be a space between you and it, about mm-hmm. 2,000 cubits by measure.
Okay.
Come not near unto it, that ye may know the way by which ye must go, for ye have not passed this way heretofore.
This is a new way. They're coming into and through this River Jordan here. And you send up, you got to follow Yahweh, just as they said, you got to follow the Levites. Because mm-hmm. that was the priesthood type, the priesthood that they had to follow. You follow? They bared and they dealt with that Ark of the Covenant. Keep reading.
And Joshua said unto the people, sanctify yourselves,
mm-hmm.
for tomorrow Yahweh will do wonders among you.
Mm-hmm.
And Joshua spake unto the priests, saying, mm-hmm. take up the Ark of the Covenant,
okay.
and pass over before the people.
Okay.
And they took up the Ark of the Covenant
mm-hmm.
and went before the people.
Now mind you, that's the Levites doing that. They're ministers. They were the ministers. They didn't get a place in the promised land. They didn't get no inheritance. You follow? Now, we're supposed to be ministers. And then you don't receive nothing. You're not receiving anything but the gospel. That's our salvation. Keep reading.
And Yahweh said unto Joshua,
uh-huh.
this day will I begin to magnify thee in the sight of all Israel.
Now Joshua's going to get magnified in the sight of all Israel. Read.
That they may know that That they may know that as I was with Moses,
okay.
so I will be with thee.
Mm-hmm.
And thou shalt command the priests that bear the Ark of the Covenant,
mm-hmm.
saying, when ye are come to the brink of the water of Jordan,
okay.
ye shall stand still in Jordan.
Mm-hmm.
And Joshua said unto the children of Israel, come hither and hear the words of Yahweh your Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
And Joshua said,
now that sounds quite familiar. After they came up out of the Red Sea, they had to go stand before Yahweh too. But now listen to what these kids say. Read.
And Joshua said, hereby ye shall know that the living El is among you.
Okay.
And that he will without fail drive out from before you.
Okay.
The Canaanites and the Hittites.
Okay.
And the Hivites and the Perizzites.
That sounds familiar, right? Back here, initially they didn't want to hear nothing of Yahweh. They didn't believe, right? That's why they ended up staying 40 years out here in the wilderness. Because he said, when they went over and spied out earlier, because they had already been over here in this side 40 years prior. And they didn't believe because they came back with that bad report. That's why I say that new offspring wasn't the same, it wasn't the same people that came up out of Egypt. That's why we have to have the washing or the renewing of our mind
right.
to be in harmony with that which we're being taught
right.
and what we're understanding and have a confidence in that which we do hear. Mm-hmm. Now that we're at this veil, this is what we're talking about. This is Joshua letting them know about these people, how they respond this time. Keep reading.
And the Girgashites, and the Amorites,
mm-hmm.
and the Jebusites.
Yep.
Behold, the Ark of the Covenant of Yahweh of all the earth passeth over before you into Jordan.
Mm-hmm. They were already in the midst of Jordan. Remember, Joshua told them to go there and stand still. That Ark is already in the midst of that River Jordan. Read.
Now, therefore, take you 12 men out of the tribes of Israel,
mm-hmm.
out of every tribe, amen. And it shall come to pass, as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests that
mm-hmm.
bear the Ark of
uh-huh.
Yahweh, the Elohim of all the okay. earth, shall rest in the waters of Jordan.
Now, right there, go back to through that soles of their feet. Now, remind you, they have to cross. Remember, this Red Sea, it opened up by Moses outstretching his arms. Mm-hmm. And it was dry ground unto the children of Israel. Mm-hmm. And they didn't get wet, but they were baptized. Because we already went through principles of what we're talking about, what we're discussing. But mind you, this time, they had to put the soles of their feet in the water. You ain't have Joshua out there holding up his arms and that River Jordan just parting is what I'm expressing. Mm-hmm. They had to do something.
Right.
We have to do something. Okay. You follow? Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
You want me to read the 13th verse again?
If you would, please. Mm-hmm.
And it shall come to pass, mm-hmm. as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests that mm-hmm. bear the ark of Yahweh the Elohim mm-hmm. of all the earth
yes.
shall rest in the waters of Jordan,
yes.
that the waters of Jordan shall be cut off from the waters that come down from above,
mm-hmm.
and they shall stand upon a heap.
Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
And it came to pass, when the people removed from their tents to pass over Jordan,
mm-hmm.
and the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant before the people,
mm-hmm.
and as they that bear the ark were come unto Jordan, mm-hmm. and the feet of the priests that mm-hmm. bear the ark were dipped in the brim mm-hmm. of the water, for Jordan overfloweth all his banks all the time of harvest, that the waters which came down from above stood and rose up upon an heap
mm-hmm.
very far from the city Adam that is beside Zartan.
Mm-hmm.
And those that came down towards the sea of the plain, even the salt sea, failed and were cut off. And the people passed over right against Jericho.
Mm-hmm.
And the priest that bare the Ark of the Covenant of Yahweh stood firm on dry ground
mm-hmm.
in the midst of
Jordan.
They were
in the midst of Jordan, but they put their feet there first. Read.
And all the Israelites passed over on dry ground
mm-hmm.
until all the people were passed clean over Jordan.
All the people of this generation. Not of the old generation
mm-hmm.
or that old leap or that old man. They didn't cross, that old leaven didn't cross over Jordan here. Because it was a prescribed way by which they're going to be able to come in into this most holy place. You follow? And it had to be one way in to this most holy place. You follow? Just as the high priest on the Day of Atonement had to come into this most holy place three times in that day. You follow? One time for himself and his family, and the second time for the people and their family. You follow? That's why the high priest went in first into the River Jordan, and then the people came in, and then what? The third time was for the cleansing of the sanctuary, that this high priest brought in blood and sprinkled it at this mercy seat on it three times. You follow? This is the operation of them coming through this, that the high priest himself coming through this second compartmental veil into the most holy place. You follow? And now we're going to talk about that most holy place for a minute. We got to here on Thursday, but I want to do one more next. Keep reading. Seventh plane.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Hebrews 6:19.
Just grab Joshua. This is read these in order. Joshua 14:1-3. mm-hmm. This is representing the migratory pattern by the Israelites entering into Canaan's land, or the promised land, their final earthly inheritance, and is compared to the most holy place, or the tabernacle, a type of heaven, and was fulfilled by Yahshua, the Messiah, who entered not into the holy places made with hands, but into heaven itself. This is the principle that which we're talking about. These seven steps of the migratory pattern is parroting the same seven steps in this tabernacle. And we're seeing how Yahshua Messiah is simply fulfilling these events. You follow? Now, we talked about how they got through the River Jordan. Now, we're talking about being in this most holy place. Read.
Joshua 14:1-3.
Uh-huh.
And these are the countries which the children of Israel inherited in the land of Canaan.
Okay.
Which Eleazar the priest and Joshua the son of Nun.
See, Eleazar, he was from here out of Egypt. Read.
And the heads of the fathers of the tribes of the children of Israel distributed for inheritance to them.
Right.
By lot was their inheritance as Yahweh commanded by the hand of Moses.
See, that's why this is a type and a shadow. They received something. You follow? This is our, is only that we're not receiving any physical inheritance.
Right.
When we talk about this gospel, this is not a, prosperity teaching. Where we're not going to come to class and hopefully go out tomorrow and raise $10,000. That's not our get down in this. There's no physical thing that we're striving for. You follow? Therefore, this is an example of them getting their lots from having come through this round trip, if you would, since the time of Abraham on that promise. But this is for us to see and understand, because we're not receiving any inheritance in this fashion like they did.
Right.
You follow? Keep reading where they get.
For the nine tribes and for the half tribe.
Mm-hmm.
For Moses had given the inheritance of two tribes
on this side of the river. You follow? And you got them again, another tribe on this side of the river. This is what we're talking about here. Now, go ahead and get Hebrews 6:19-20
Mm-hmm. Which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast.
An anchor of a soul, sure and steadfast. That's what they did when they crossed through this River Jordan. They were told to stand in the midst of this River Jordan on their soles of their feet. Mm-hmm. And then they received this lot that were given to them as a promise that Yahweh said, sure enough, he'll give it to them. Keep reading.
Both sure and steadfast, in which entereth into that within the veil.
Within the veil, through that veil, the River Jordan is like into that veil, read.
Whether the forerunner is for us entered, even Yahshua.
See, the Ark of the Covenant was the forerunner of them entering in. But Yahshua is our forerunner. Keep reading.
Yahshua made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek.
Mm-hmm. After that promise, that was promise of that seed that was promising to Abraham that he would bear a seed, right? That is Yahshua in the order of Melchizedek, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Keep reading.
For this Melchizedek, King of Salem, priest of the Most High, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him.
Okay.
To whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation, King of Righteousness, and after that also King of Salem, which is King of Peace.
And that's what Yahshua is fulfilling. That promise and giving them that inheritance. You got 6:19.
I did that one. You did it.
The 19.
9:24.
That was 7. That was 7.
We moved it over to 7.
Oh, okay. Can you go on to 9:24?
Right. For the Messiah is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of Yahweh for us. Nor yet that he should offer himself often, as the high priest entered into the holy place every year with other blood.
That's what we talked about. And this is Yahshua on the day that he ascended, after 40 days of tarrying on earth, he ascended into the right hand of Yahweh, right? For us. Keep reading. Why he do it for us? This is what we want to find out. Read.
For then must he also have suffered since the foundation of the world.
Since the time of the foundation of the world. Read.
But now, once in the end of the age, has he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself.
Now, this is why Yahshua is here, that once to put away sin. I told you that Yahshua Messiah was born, raised, and died within the fourth dispensation. Because when he died on that cross, that was the end of an age. That was an end of an age. And so now he, after 10 days after his 50 days after his resurrection, you have the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. You follow? Read.
And as it is appointed unto men once to die.
Yes.
But after this, the judgment.
Mm-hmm.
So the Messiah was once
That's offered. Why people think you're going to be judged after you die.
Yeah.
That's we're talking about them in this age. You follow? It don't apply to us now in this age because we have the knowledge and the information in order to learn about the judging and what that judgment is. You follow? Keep reading.
So the Messiah was once offered to bear the sins of many.
Yes.
And unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time.
See, the second time. They're waiting for him to come back out of the sky now. But we were just reading that he came in this age in to fulfill the things of this age.
Mm-hmm.
Now at the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, we have the information and the knowledge to learn about that judgment. Now before our second death.
Right.
That's why we have to know now and not after we die.
Right.
Keep reading.
Shall he appear the second time without sin offering unto salvation?
Right. And there's no sin offering. We're going to be able to give any sacrifices as an offering to restore our sins of not knowing who and what he is. Read.
That's the end.
That's the end of that. Mm-hmm. Now we want to talk about after this threefold, this death, burial, resurrection, 40 ascension. And we want to be able to see how it's a spiritual ascension for us, or a spiritual fulfillment for us. I want to put it that way. So I want to go to Hebrews 6 and 1 and read the top part of this, what denotes perfection. And actually, I want to, on the textbook, I want to start on page 126 and read across.
There are seven steps, dimensions, or planes, often referred to as heavens, whereas there are but three heavens, which leads to perfection. The seven steps, dimensions, or planes are revealed in the pattern of the tabernacle, and in the greater and more perfect tabernacle, the universe.
That's what we just went through. Read.
Called the migratory pattern,
which
was pitched by Yahweh Elohim and not the man, Moses.
This Yahweh Elohim, this greater, more perfect tabernacle was pitched by Yahweh. You follow? This tabernacle was pitched by man out of a vision that was given to Moses to build. Okay, keep reading.
Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of the Messiah, let us go on into perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works.
And that works are the Ten Commandments, are the carnal ordinances that he came in and nailed to the cross. We're no longer fulfilling those things or performing those things because we now believe that he has come and he has resurrected. You follow? And it has given us eternal life because what? We know the one true El and Yahshua the Messiah who Yahweh has sent. Keep reading.
And a faith towards Yahweh.
You see, we have a faith towards Yahweh. Read.
Of the doctrine of baptism and of laying on of hands and of resurrection of the dead and of eternal judgment.
Of eternal judgment in the spirit. We're not laying on our hands and we're not baptizing people in water. We're baptizing people in the name of Yahshua Messiah, right? And we're laying on the hands like Elohim has laid on our consciousness about who he was. Because back here, he didn't lay. They did eat and drink with this super incorporeal being, but he did not lay hands on them or gave them the understanding. Now we have the understanding to lay hands or lay the conversation to you about how and what things really were and what it's really like. That's why I went Hebrews 1 and 2. Sixth chapter, Hebrews. Hebrews 6, 1
Hebrews
and 2.
Hebrews 6 and 1.
Therefore,
leaving the beginnings.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Therefore, leaving the beginnings of the doctrine of the Messiah, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance.
See, we're not laying this foundation of baptisms, Lord's Suppers, and sacrifices. You follow? Not at all. Not in one iota are we caring to baptize anybody with any physical water. Read.
Not laying again the foundation of repentance from works of death and of faith toward Yahweh. Of the doctrine of baptisms and of laying on of hands and of resurrection of the dead and of eternal judgment. And this will we do if Yahweh permit. For those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift.
You see what I said? There was once they had come into this holy place and had tasted of the heavenly gift. But what happened to them?
And were made partakers of the Holy Spirit, and have tasted the good word of Yahweh and the powers of the ages to come, if they shall fall away, it is impossible to renew them again unto repentance.
Now look, I just said that some have come into that holy place. Some have seen and witnessed the Yahweh-given spirit. You follow? But yet if they give it away... She just read it. If they give it away, it would be impossible for them to get it again. Keep reading.
Seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of Yahweh afresh and put him to an open shame. For the earth which drinketh in the rain that cometh oft upon it.
See, that's and this is what we have here. The whole world. It's what you said, the pink book, the churches or the Pope, they restore these carnal ordinances. You follow? In order to deny the way, the truth, and the life, which is Yahshua Messiah, who had demonstrated through the fulfilling of the law for us to see how to see that law in us after this cross. The New Testament is written in our heart and mind. This is how we're supposed to come now before Yahweh and to be able to live and have our being within the righteousness of the Holy Spirit. What is that? It's the faith of Yahshua, of what he's demonstrated down from Adam through Noah, through the Tower of Babel, through the Abrahamic promise, and through the Mosaic law. Having nailed the law to the cross, whereby we're going to be able to understand the pureness of the law according to his righteousness. Grant me Hebrews 8. I think that's the end of that for Hebrews. Go back to Hebrews 8.
8. You want 10, 13?
Yeah.
Okay. But this is the covenant that I will make. You want me to start up further?
That's fine. Yeah, that's fine.
Where you want to go?
Hebrews 10.
8 and 10?
8.
But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, said Yahweh.
See, after the days we just went over talking about this seven steps. After these days, and then after Yahshua the Messiah fulfilling these days, right? These are all the days that Saul is talking about to the Hebrews. Read.
I will put my law into their mind and write them in their hearts.
See, now that law is going to be written in our minds and in our heart about what we know about Yahshua the Messiah according to what he instituted and what he fulfilled. When we see a clear picture of how that spirit is operating, then we'll see how when he writes it within our heart and mind, we'll have the faith and the confidence to do what he says do. Read.
And I will be to them their Elohim, and they shall be to me my people.
Right.
And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know ye Yahweh, for all shall know me from the least to the greatest.
That's in Hebrews, but we know that that's what Jeremiah talked about in 31:31 as well, right? Being in the law, that was going to always be a precursor of what's going to happen now at the end of this age, the age of the present kingdom age, now that this is going to be a law that's written in us, right? That's why we can't have no sermon prescriptive, because we're not knowing what to do or what to say. You follow? He told the disciples, he said, hey, Don't give any thought of what you're going to say when you go out and preach the doctrine of God, of Yahshua the Messiah, right? So therefore, neither do we. Because we can see, having been shown by the way of Dr. Kinney, having been the vessel that instituted or brought in this gospel for us and showed us how this divine vision and revelation is in harmony with the whole shebang of what we have in our Bible. You follow? And how we are able to come into a knowledge of Yahshua the Messiah. Keep reading there in Hebrews.
For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, mm-hmm. and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. Mm-hmm. In that he said, a new covenant he hath made the first old. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away.
Mm-hmm.
Going to 9.
Yeah.
Then verily the first covenant had also orders of service and a worldly sanctuary.
Mm-hmm.
For in the first compartment of the tabernacle was the candlestick, mm-hmm. the table, and the showbread, which is called the holy place.
Mm-hmm.
And beyond the veil, the second compartment of the tabernacle, which is called the Holy of Holies, which had the golden censer and the Ark of the Covenant overlaid round about with gold, wherein was the golden pot that had manna and Aaron's rod that budded and the table of the covenant.
Saul's talking about this tabernacle and this covenant or this most holy place, about the things and the furnishings in here whereby we can look at and look to as our as a example of what he's talking about the spirit. Keep reading.
And overhead the cherubim of glory shadowing the mercy seat, mm-hmm. of which we cannot now speak particularly. Now, when these things were thus ordained,
mm-hmm.
the priests, which always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service.
Mm-hmm. That's the holy place, is that first compartment. That's where they were able to operate here, in this compartment. When nobody operated up here in the most holy place, they were only able to go up there and perform three times a year, one time a day. So they weren't performing all the time. This was the sanctuary that they were performing. This is where we are working with the light, the bread, and the intercessor. This is our work where we're able to minister in the tabernacle. Keep reading.
But into the second, went mm-hmm. the high priest alone once mm-hmm. every year.
This is the second one we just talked about, read.
Not without blood, which he offered right. for himself and for the heirs of the people.
Mm-hmm.
The Holy Spirit signifying this, that the way into the Holy of Holies was not yet made manifest,
mm-hmm.
while the first tabernacle was yet standing,
right,
which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience.
See, it's pertaining to the conscience, and this is what Acts is talking about, Acts 2:20-38. And I'll be right done. See, all this tabernacle here was good for our learning. But when we come into the purpose of why this was set up, as we just went through 7 steps about what this migratory or the greater, more perfect tabernacle was about, it's all to in order to clear our consciousness about who and what we are, mm-hmm. and according to what our purpose is, right? And that is to know the one true El, and Yahshua, who Yahweh sent. And when we are able to do that, read Acts 2:38.
28 or?
38. Sorry.
Acts 2:38. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be immersed, every one of you, in the name of Yahshua the Messiah.
That right there. That's our baptism, being baptized in the name of Yahshua Messiah, read.
For the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the
gift. Your sins are the ones that you have, that you've brought up, that you've indoctrinated into your own self, you follow? That you were innocent in the beginning, but as you were brought up and told this and that, and things have confounded you, and you begin to want to seek Yahweh or seek another way, depending on how much thumb pressure he done put on you to seek Yahweh, that's all on you. That was never written in the law back here with Moses. That's your own egotistical, misdirected person, your own leaven that you brought upon your own self. And now we're saying be baptized in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. Keep reading.
For the remission of sins.
For the remission of your sins. Read.
And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.
And see, you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Read.
For the promise is unto you and to your children.
And of your thoughts. All. Of your thoughts. Of your thoughts. The new children of your thoughts. Remember, the new children had to cross over.
Right.
Your thoughts. Your children are your thoughts. Your new way of looking at the gospel of Yahshua Messiah according to his purpose, pattern, plan. No longer your old Egyptian way of thinking or your old leaven of bread. That had to die on the altar if you're listening. That got to go. And now when you understand the true gospel or the purpose of Yahshua Messiah coming in to fulfill, he's fulfilling in you. And you're giving up those things or those diabolical things that set you on edge. Your problem's not my problem. My problem's not your problem. And our problem's not the Ten Commandment law. Our problem's what we were raised up with in order to put things on people. Now that we've come off this, off ourselves, now we have our new thoughts that do what? Read.
For the promise is unto you and to your children.
The thoughts of your children, the promise is given to you. And now you got to manage and control your thoughts about what you're receiving. Read.
And to all that are far off,
mm-hmm.
even as many as Yahweh our Elohim shall call.
Mm-hmm.
And with many other words did mm-hmm. he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this perverse generation.
Hallelujah. If you got anything out of today's class, all praises to Yahweh our Elohim by way of Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
That will be the end of our today's Sunday class, and I hope everyone enjoyed it as I have. Do we have any announcements? No? Okay. If not, let us all stand and be dismissed with the doxology from Jude, the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before now and never. Let us all say, hallelujah.